Methodist Church had a lightning strike and they're not be able to be on today. Brother Ken Lyons is working 7A to 7P today in Stabler Hospital in Greenville. I hope he's listening. Thank you, Brother Ken, for thinking about us to put us back on the radio today. And all you that listens and turns in, I know you're not expecting us to be on today, but maybe you just turned by there. Somebody called and said, hey, that preacher, that wild preacher's on this morning. You need to turn and listen to him. Amen. That one that preaches long time and loud and continuous, you need to turn him on and listen to him. Amen. Amen. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and then the Gentiles. That's us. We came sliding in at the last minute. Amen. But thank God we made it. How about you this morning? Boy, I got the preacher's itch today. Have you got the listener's itch? I mean, you've been crying all week and you've been suffering all week and you've been battling all week and the devil's tried to divide you all week and he's tried to separate you all week. And have I missed anything yet? All this has been going on for about 2 or 3 weeks and your sword's done got dull and your shield's got a couple of holes in it and you've been dragging your helmet and dragging your breastplate. You've been dragging all this stuff. So just to be able to get to the house of the Lord this morning and say, preacher, I got to have something from heaven. God needs to touch me. If you're that person, shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! The house is full of hallelujahs this morning. Amen. I feel good in the spirit today. Amen. I got a funeral to preach after a while, then I'm going to preach again tonight. But hey, that just lets me know God's got my order right in His hands and I'm excited about what the Lord's going to do. Now, I want you to turn with me. I'm in the 12th chapter of the book of Acts. And I really feel like preaching this morning. Can you tell? I really feel like preaching this morning. And before I read the scripture, I want us to pray again. It's good to have Brother Bill and Sister Pam Stokes back with us this morning. God bless you. Appreciate you being here today. Sister Pam broke her leg here a while back, but she made it to church this morning. Some folks ain't got a broke leg and they still didn't make it. Come on, preacher, let's don't get there. We're meddling now. Let's pray. Father, we love you this morning. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, Lord, for that amazing grace, God, that reigns on us today. Lord, and we thank you for the favor and the blessings of God. For I decree I will walk in the favor of God today. Lord, and my expectation is so high on you today, Lord. And Lord, I expect things to happen because of you. And Lord, because of your hand being upon this church and this ministry and God, this people today. And I praise you for it, Lord. I thank you for revival. I thank you, Lord, that revival is spreading all in South Alabama. God, I ask you to stir up the people. Give them a hunger and a thirst after righteousness. Now, Lord, I pray for that anointing that makes preaching easy. Lord, let my mind be stayed upon this scripture that you've laid in my heart. And God, don't let me miss a point. Don't let me miss a nugget of wisdom, God, as I preach this message. And Lord, I pray for all those at Radio Land today, God, that you'd open up their hearts. And Lord, we got church members that's sick and they're tuned in. I pray, God, let them turn it up. Let them turn the radio up. Lord, they need to hear what I'm going to preach about this morning. Now, Lord, I'm giving you praise for it. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. I want to preach a message entitled, I'm in prison. I'm in prison. Have you ever been in prison? Some folks are in prison and they don't have the crossbar hotel sign out front. Some people are just in prison or in bondage every day. It's a sad state when we are in prison because we Christians ought to know that, hey, I'm not going to be here. I may be passing through in vision, but I'm not going to be here long. In the 12th chapter of Acts, it records something, and I got to lay the groundwork here now before I preach. Peter was one of the most needful apostles or disciples that Jesus had. Every time he turned a corner, he had to deal with Peter. Every time he moved, he had to deal with Peter. Every time Jesus ministered, he had to deal with Peter. I mean, when he told the disciples, go and get loaves of bread to feed these 5,000, Peter said, Lord, there ain't enough bread in town to feed them. And they had to go out and find somebody that had enough bread and enough fish to feed the crowd. What'd you bring to church with you this morning to feed the crowd? Oh, I felt that on my feet, y'all. But every time that Jesus dealt with anything, he had to deal with Peter first. Now, does God have to deal with you first before he can deal with anything else? Does he have to deal with you to get the vision across, but does he have to get you prepared for the vision before he can give you that vision? What does God have to do in your life this morning while you're in prison to get you ready for what he has for you? Because some of you have been fighting in the last few weeks, and that fight has been the fight to get to a next level, to get to a deeper place in God, to be focused, because the devil scattered your mind. I know he scattered your mind because God's been talking to me about scattering your mind. But I want to preach to you about I'm in prison. All right? Verse 1, 12th chapter of the book of Acts. Now, Acts should have been the fifth gospel. It's the action gospel. It's the birth of the church. It's the battles of the apostles, so to speak. It's what they had to go through in order to establish God in that part of the world and all over the world. So in Acts chapter 12, God's having to deal with Peter after Pentecost, which he was a better apostle after Pentecost, naturally, but he still had to go through some things before he could get to that epitaph of his ministry, so to speak. Verse 1 said, "Now about that time, just when you get it going, the devil steps in." Just about the time you get everything lined up, the devil steps in front of you. So like the pool of Bethesda. Now I got 55 minutes to preach, y'all. Just like the pool of the Bethesda, Jesus asked the crippled man there, "Would you be made whole?" Here's his answer while he was in prison there, said, "When the water's troubled, somebody else steps in ahead of me." What's happening to you this morning is the devil is stepping in front of you trying to stop what God has got in your life. And therefore, he's put you in prison, and I'm going to explain it all in a minute. Herod the king stretched forth his hands, listen to these next words, to vex certain, handpicked, the devil handpicked you. Everybody's not going through what you're going through this morning. The devil handpicked you. He handpicked you because you are one of the important ones. You're one of those people that God has got something tremendous for your life. And I want to tell you, God picked you long before you got saved. He planned out your course long before you said, "Jesus, forgive me of my sins." He already had your destination in his heart and in his mind and in his plans. Amen? So here's what the Bible said. To vex, now vex is just really not a good word. Vex means trouble, troublesome, on top of discouragement, on top of discouragement, on top of trouble. He vexed them. In other words, you couldn't get away from it. It's been around you, beside you, over your head and under your feet. Vexed means you have to deal with it all the time. It walks with you. I didn't say it was in you. I just said it walks with you. And the reason it's there is to hinder what God's putting in your life this morning. Amen. The devil saw we was in revival. And boy, have we been through something since we've shut down to go into Easter. Boy, we've been pulled a sword and it's done got dull, got chips in the blade. It's got little bitty nicks in the shield. I mean, we've been going through something since revival slowed down here. That's the vex here. That vexes us. Now listen to this. And he goes on to say this. Certain of the church. Not everybody of the church, just certain people in the church, certain ministries in the church, certain apostles in the church. I was thinking about this coming to church this morning. The Lord, in this little book right here in this chapter, it doesn't mention Matthew, it doesn't mention Nathaniel, it doesn't mention Philip, it don't mention anybody, but it mentions James and it mentions Peter. So there was certain of the church that the devil vexed. He knew if he could get the head, the mouthpiece, and the zeal of the church, somebody ought to be shouting right now. If he could get you discouraged and fussing and fighting and dividing, he could get the whole church. Oh, I got a good mind to run just to make the devil mad. Now listen to this. Verse 2. And he killed the pastor at the church in Jerusalem. He killed the pastor, James, at the church in Jerusalem. Still working on the head. Still working on the leader. Still trying to discourage the whole church. Still trying to destroy what God's doing in the church. He don't want nobody healed. The devil don't. He don't want nobody saved. He wants you all fussing and fighting and quarreling, bringing guns to church, bringing knives to church. He wants you in such a battle you can't hear God. You can't sense God. You can't know God. You can't fight yourself. The devil's trying to kill you and destroy you because he wants the work of the church to die out. But I got news for him. Jesus told Peter, upon this rock, and this is God's talking, I'll build my church. It's not my church. It's not your church. It's God's church. I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Woo. I'm in prison. I'm in prison. Listen to this. Kill James, the brother of John, with a sword. He didn't kill John. I know John was close to Jesus. He laid on him and he was always around him. John was one of them people you love to be around. Peter was one of them you love to have a quaint acquaintance. But God chose Peter for a reason. Peter was just bold in what he did. He had the power to suffer. He had the power to suffer. He had the power to be an overcomer. He had the power to rise again. He had the power to make a mistake, but he had the power to repent. He had the power to stand in the gap. He had the power of God in him to be able to go through anything that God throwed his way. He had the power. That's the reason the devil handpicked him. Listen to this. He killed James, his brother of John, with a sword, and because he saw it pleased the Jews. You see, the devil works on religious folks. Now I need to define religious folks. Religious folks shows up to church, but they haven't prayed. Religious folks tote Bibles, but they don't read. Religious folks like to sing in the choir, but they can't sing a lick. You know, like that old man where they sing that old song, please let me sing in the choir, in the choir. Please let me sing in the choir. I can't sing a lick, don't you know? Please let me sing in the choir. Some people just can't sing. Some people just show up, religious folks. Amen. They don't want to do anything, but they want everything to evolve around them. Come on, somebody. Listen, religious folks just wants to dictate. And that's what was going on here. All the Sanhedrin had come against the message of Peter that preached, and they come against him because they didn't like him because he had liberty in Christ. When you praising the Lord going down the road, the devil don't like you. When you standing up in the house of the Lord, the devil don't like you. When you're praising and worshiping and studying and crying at home, amen, when you're watering your fields with the tears that you shed in your prayer closet, the devil don't like that. He wants you to think everybody is against you. He wants you to think nobody likes you. They don't care about you. They ain't called you on the phone. They ain't come by and witnessed to you. They hadn't done anything. But let's take an inventory. Who have you been to see? Amen. He only works on you because you hadn't been nowhere to see anybody either. Remember, they killed James, but I ain't going to let you kill me. I'll go out this door here. Come on, somebody. Listen to this now. This is going to get good. I'm in prison. So he proceeded further, verse 3, to take who? Oh, my Lord. In other words, God said, have you considered Peter? He's an unlikely suspect. He causes chaos everywhere he goes. I mean, everybody recognized Peter right off. Some folks didn't know Nathanael. Jesus saw him, said, while thou was under the fig tree, I saw thee. So he picked Peter. I guess he thought Peter, since he crumbled at the little old barrel where they had the fire at the whipping post when Jesus was heading to the cross, I reckon they thought that Peter was just weak and would have been one of them that caved in and folded under pressure. What kind of a deal are you this morning? Do you cave in under pressure? You know what makes a piece of metal cave in? It has to be bent first. It has to have more weight on it than it's able to bear. But Jesus said, I won't put on you more than you're able to bear. And with every temptation, I've made a way of escape. Amen? So we got an escape route. I got to read on now. I got to hurry. Then it says in verse 4, and when he had apprehended him, has he caught you yet? Has the devil got you yet? Has he whispered enough in your ear and told you enough lies until you believed him? You know you're not going to believe that lie to start with. But he's going to point out things. This one's that, that one's that, this one's that. But now the Bible said, don't tell me to work out Brother Jerusalem's salvation with my fear and trembling. He says, work out my own salvation with fear and trembling and shedding of tears and studying in God's Word. We find ourselves in God's Word. This is where, hey, this is a mirror. When we read this word, we can see ourselves right here. And listen, this is what it said, verse 4. And when he had apprehended him, in other words, he caught Peter. He caught him. Does that mean that he won't catch me and you? Yes, he will. Does that mean he won't attack me and you? Yes, he will. The devil is no respecter person. He'll attack you, he'll catch you, he'll deceive you because he's a master at deception. You can't fight him on your own. I want to tell you what the Lord spoke to me this morning. Said, when you're sick, you go to the doctor. But when you're spiritual sick, you don't go to church. The doctor can't help you spiritually. He'll give you a sugar pill. And every cure ain't sweet now. Come on. Every cure is not sweet. A lot of cures is bitterness, travailing, tears, separation, seclusion. Sometimes I think we need to have a prayer closet away from the telephone, away from the telegraph, away from everything we can come in contact with, and just get in that prayer closet and say, God, I ain't coming out of here till you get all this baggage off of me, out of me, away from me. I don't want to hear nobody talking. I don't want nobody complaining. I don't want the phone ringing. I don't want the TV playing. Lord, the only voice I want to hear is that still, small voice that comes down from heaven, and I know it's the truth because it sets me free. But Lord, I'm in prison. Now listen to this. And when he had apprehended him, the first place he put him was and put him in prison. Let me paint you a picture here in prison. Prison is a type of bondage. Prison is a place of depression. Prison is a place of I just don't understand why I'm going through what I'm going through. And why I have to be where I have to be. That's what prison is. Prison is when you look at your surroundings. Prison is when you get to a place after your good works. You pray a week. Boy, you feel good about yourself. Amen. You read a chapter a day for 5 days. I feel good about myself. And all of a sudden, the devil apprehends you. Amen. And he puts you in prison. And you get depressed. What actually happens is you get mad with God. God, I've done what you said. I prayed and I've read. And why am I here? You still hadn't learned. You still hadn't learned. Prison is a place where you learn some things. Prison is a place of seclusion. That means you got to fight your... Am I preaching to anybody here this morning? Prison is a place that you have to fight your own battle, win your own battle, come out with your own victory. You can't read a book and get out of there. You can't hear a tape and get out of there. You can't hear a song and get out of there. It's sheer determination. I'm not going to spend the rest of my life in prison or in bondage. I'm coming out of this thing, Lord. I'm not going to be here long. I'm going to learn what I need to learn. I'm going to take it to heart. And when I come out of here, I'm going to have two swords. I'm going to have the Old Testament. I'm going to have the New Testament. Our shield's going to be as big as a Roman shield, and I'm coming out fighting. Amen. And they put him in prison. Now, they didn't just put him in a cell and close the door and lock it. You see, the devil won't just put you in a cell by yourself because he don't want you to get out. He wants to discourage you while you're there. Listen to this. And delivered him to four quadrants of soldiers. Four soldiers, one on each side of Peter, escorted him in prison. Did you hear me? Four quadrants of soldiers. So you don't fight just one devil. You got to fight four devils. And they're under command of Satan. And these four devils have got you surrounded. One on each arm, one at the gate of the jail, or standing guard there, two of them. So when you look up and something else happens here, they place Peter between two guards and two chains. See, you thought you just had one chain to deal with, but you got two. Sometimes there's some people that the devil has to double up on. See, because you've won so many victories in the times past until he don't want you to get loose. What's your problem this morning? Has God brought you out before? Now you listen, I'm preaching to people all over this radio land this morning. I'm preaching to you this morning. Because you've been in prison. You've been in prison. And the devil has bound you by chains between two guards. And he stuck a guard at the door, two of them. So every time you look at that door for somebody to come get you, you still see bondage. And the devil said, there's no way out of this. We're not going to survive this. Devil, you a liar. Amen. Hey, I said, devil, you a liar. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care what it feels like. Devil, you a liar. I'm coming out of this prison. I'm not going to be here. I'm not going to stay here. I'm not going to camp here. I'm not going to do anything here. I'm just passing through. I'm going to learn I got the power over hell. I got the power over religion. I've got the power. All I've got to do is wait on God. And God's going to bring me out and the chains are going to begin to fall. And their jobs were to keep him. The devil's job is to keep you in your state. Amen? I said the devil's job is to keep you in your state. He don't want you to have victory. He don't want you to get a glimmer of hope. He don't want any of that to happen to you because he knows that just when the light shines, if you can just see a glimmer of the master walking by on the window of the outside of that jail, you know one thing. If the Lord's on your side, the devil has to flee. If the Lord's on your side, the prison doors will have to be open. If the Lord's on your side, there ain't nothing the devil's got that's going to move you away from God. Intending that after Easter to bring him before the people. The devil's just waiting for the right opportunity. See, you're just in prison, but he's waiting for the right time to destroy you. You hear me? He's waiting for the right time to destroy you. And they had to wait till after Easter. It means Passover. He had to wait till after Passover because they knew that if they bothered Peter during the Passover, the people of God would rise up against him. So the devil chooses his time. The devil will choose you when you're vulnerable. He'll choose you when you're down. He'll choose you when you're going through the worst battle, like a broke leg that you've ever had in your life. He'll choose you when you're alone and nobody's calling or coming or sending food. He'll choose that time to sow that seed. Amen. He'll choose that time to do that, to discourage you from serving God or pressing on. Amen. He'll choose that time. And he chooses it well. Because he knew during Passover he couldn't touch them. But he still held them in prison. Right. Just because we celebrate Easter don't mean you getting out.
That's right.
Can I preach right there?
Amen.
Just because you worship God at the resurrection don't mean you come out. You're still in prison.
Amen.
You may be able to praise him a little bit, but your praise is hindered here. Simply because you're not free. You're still in bondage. You're in prison. You want to praise him, but you can't get your hands up because you're bound by two chains with two soldiers and you're laying in that prison. And nobody, the preacher ain't even coming by there, ain't talking to you or nothing. You're just laying there. Now listen to this. Verse 5. Peter therefore was kept in prison. He stayed. They wasn't going to let him out. The devil ain't going to let you out. I don't care what kind of celebration it is. He's not going to let you out because he knows if you can get around God's people. Oh, that's right. If you're mad with God's people, then you can't get no help there. Paul said that we were biting one another. Did he not say that? Is that not scripture? Biting one another. So you can't bite one another. That's not your problem. Your problem is you are in prison. Because the devil chose to put you there.
Why ain't he got the pastor by the hand?
I've had people say, that preacher don't go through nothing, man. You ain't walked in these shoes. They ain't a half, well, narrow shoes, but you ain't walked a step in them yet. Amen. Some of these battles, brother, these shoes is overloaded. Amen. But listen to me this morning. The devil handpicked you because he saw you was up and rising. He saw that you was up and rising. He said, I can't let them get in power. I can't let them have faith. I can't let them be encouraged. Let them be with the zeal of the Lord in them. I can't let them get to that place, so I'm going to put them in prison. I'm going to put them between two soldiers, and I'm going to put two chains on them. And that way, that'll discourage them into trying to get out of there. But here's what the Bible said. Prayer was made without ceasing. See, what you don't know is there's people praying. Well, preacher, I'm praying too. Yeah, but you're praying the wrong prayer. Now, how do you know I'm praying the wrong prayer? It ain't working. You ain't out. And it's in the wrong direction. Because I got your attention in it. How does that preacher know I'm praying the wrong prayer? Because it's not working. We've got to pray in travail. Pray in the Holy Ghost. So the devil don't know what you're praying. You don't even know what you're praying. Paul said we utter sounds that we ordinarily can't utter. It's when we are interceding. That's the reason you have to pray in the Holy Ghost. That's the reason you have to pray in tongues. Amen? That's the reason you have to submit yourself therefore unto the Lord and resist the devil and he'll flee from. And listen, when you resist, that means you got to get out of that place. You can't remain in that same spot. When God begins to set us free, you can't remain in that same spot. You got to get out of there. If you stay in that same spot, Paul said, you'll be entangled again with the cares of this world. They will entangle you again. You got to make a move. You got to make a march. You got to come clear of that thing. If you don't come clear, it'll bind you up again. Amen? It'll bind you up again. And remember, you're not in jail and in prison by yourself. You're tied to two and there's two at the door. And you say, if I just get through these two, I got it made. No. You can't do it. There's three more things you got to deal with. One of them is a locked door. And then once you get the door open, you got two more soldiers to deal with. Amen? Listen to this. But prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. Did you know there's still people praying for revival in this house? Amen. Praying for revival for this house. Remember, Rhoda, Peter again was in trouble. Rhoda was praying. The church was praying here. All her grannies and all her aunts were praying. We're praying, Lord, would you bring Peter out? Not knowing he wasn't going to come out. Not knowing he was going to come out. Well, what was y'all doing? We was praying. What was you praying for? Well, we was praying for the will of the Lord. Now, you know that's a cop-out half the time. When you pray, be specific about what you're praying. I can't get on that. I got to stay with it where I'm at. Because you're in prison. Listen to this. Verse 6. And when Herod would have brought him forth, when the devil knows exactly the time to bring you forth, to persecute you, and to destroy you, and to throw you under the bus, he's got a strategic time to do that. There's a strategic time for people to come by your house and whisper in your ear. Most time it's Saturday night before you come to church on Sunday. Rattle, 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 rattle. He knows just exactly the time to send them by there. And Facebook, he knows just exactly when to click that little message deal on the front of your... Y'all know what I'm talking about. It's got that little lightning deal in it. That don't mean it's light. It just means it's sharp. Listen to this. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night... I mean, the strategic time, that same night, Peter was asleep between two soldiers. Now listen to me. When Peter was bound and they put him between them two soldiers with two chains, he wasn't worried. What's your problem? You're scared. You're worried. You're distraught. I'm not ever going to come out of this mess. It's the same old thing. Oh, man, thank you, Holy Ghost. You know why it's the same old thing? Pastor, I don't know why I have to deal with this all the time. Well, you're in the wilderness. Oh, there it is again. I have to deal with that stump again. You know, there's that. It looks just like that last stump I went over. Let me tell you something, it was the last stump. It was the last stump because we ain't done nothing with it. It's the same stump in our path over and over and over again. Therefore, we're in the wilderness. Until we take the stump out and fix the pothole, we're going to walk in the same place. And when we change our direction... Did you know they could have been, the children of Israel could have been in the promised land in 2.5 weeks? I want you to get a glimpse of this. But it took them 40 years. And you know what God did? He told the priest, he told Moses, he said, don't you let the tabernacle be in the same place. Because we'll get in a rut, y'all. I don't know about Baptist, I don't know about Church of God, but Assemblies of God to get in a rut. You better not sing over 3 songs and you we'll get in a rut. Don't you let the Lord have a hold of the church service because the roast will be burnt time we get to the house. We'll have to go to McDonald's and we know how we don't like McDonald's. Well, we do. We like McDonald's. We eat there all the time. But now listen to this. He was asleep between two soldiers. His circumstance didn't change. His outcome didn't look like it was going to change, but Peter was asleep. He slept like a baby. When he laid down there, I know what Peter thought. He thought, man, God's going to get me out of here. I don't know how he's going to do it. I don't know when he's going to do it, but I know by the time tomorrow gets here, I've got hope in God. I've got hope in him. Now listen to this. He said, bound with two chains, one's not enough. The young people do a drama here, and they got a chain there that part of that song and that drama says, I can hear chains falling. You know, we ain't heard any fall lately. We've heard them rattle. We felt the weight on them. Just hadn't heard any fall lately. I hear the chains fall. I wish I could sing, boy. Falling. Two chains. One's for depression and one's for discouragement. Depression and discouragement. I hope you've got the picture of you being in prison and what it looks like. Now listen to this. And the keepers before the door kept the prison. You got more than one problem here. You got more than two problems here. You actually got five problems here. Actually, you got seven problems. You got a soldier on each side and a chain on each side. So that makes four. And you hadn't defeated them yet because you've had to go to sleep. You've been there so long. And then the other three problems are on the outside of the prison cell. You ain't even got to them yet. You don't know what's going to happen when God finally turns you loose. Amen? Am I preaching to anybody here this morning? Looking at the cell door, you can see through it, and you see two more guards out there. But the good thing about them, they didn't have any chains. I reckon they run out of chains when he strapped them down. But there's a gate that's locked. You've got to deal with the locked gate and the two guards out here. It's a big old iron gate. And not only that, there's another gate in another place that you got to deal with, but you can't even go there yet because you're not out of prison. Some criminals are career criminals because they can't deal with the outside. I'm fixing to get in trouble here. Some people are drama queens and drama kings, and they don't want it any other way. They want it just like that so they can deal with things. Verse 7. Oh, I got to touch right here. The keeper of the door of the prison, he's always there. You can't catch him going to the bathroom. He's not going to take a nap because there's a charge of death on him. If he leaves his station and you come out of that prison, they will kill him. Amen? They will kill him. You can read about that in Acts 16. And 16 and 25. Listen to this. And it says this, verse 7. And behold, when you read that word behold, it means something's fixing to change. You've got to pay attention. When God says behold, it's time to pay attention. Amen? Have you ever wrestled all night? Have you ever stayed awake and wet your pillow with tears? If you hadn't, you hadn't been in through anything yet. But I want to let you know something. When you wrestle all night, like Jacob did to the breaking of the day, when you wrestle all night, something's good's fixing to happen. And the Bible said, and behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him. The angel of the Lord came upon Peter. Let's look at this deal, would you? The angel of the Lord did not change his circumstance. It didn't take his chain off. It didn't kill the soldiers. It didn't even open the gate. He didn't even put the two outside to sleep like he did when Jesus' resurrection and they lay his dead man. He didn't even do that. He came upon Peter. And when the angel of the Lord came upon Peter, something phenomenal happened. Listen to this. A light shined in your prison. It's been dark until now. And the reason it's been dark is because you can't figure how you're going to get out of there. And you know after Passover, they're going to bring you before the people and they want to see you dead. They want to kill you. And the reason they want to kill you is to shut your mouth. You got to quit preaching about Jesus. You got to quit working miracles. You can't even walk down the street and your shadow cast upon somebody and they're healed. You can't do that. They want to destroy God's work in your life. That's the purpose of you being in prison. Now listen to this. And a light shined in that prison. And the angel walked up to Peter and he smote him on the side. Oh, man. Smote him on the side. I mean, just, he woke him up. Peter was in a deep sleep and he just tapped him on the side. Sometimes God nudges us and we don't move. Sometimes God speaks to us and we don't listen. I mean, sometimes God does a lot of things and we just can't believe it. We're like Elijah in the cave. Earthquake came by, he said, that ain't God. The wind came by, and that ain't God. The fire came by the cave, and that ain't God. And the God's in all that. But it was a still small voice that moved him. Sometimes that still small voice don't move us. But we've got to start paying attention to what God speaks to us because he's not going to holler at us. Amen? But now listen to this. And it says here, and he smote Peter on the side, and this is what he did. He raised him up. You can't raise yourself up. You can't get out of it yourself. If you did, we didn't need Jesus. We didn't need the Word. If you could get out of it by yourself, the Lord wouldn't have had to come down. But he sent an angel here into this prison cell. And let me tell you something. God's not concerned about prisons. He's not concerned about guards. He's not concerned about chains. He's not concerned about gates. He's not concerned about anything. He's concerned about you. Because he's given you the power to be an overcomer and you're laying in prison in two chains with two guards and not making an effort to get out. So therefore God sent an angel to Peter because he is asleep. Smote him on the side. Now the rest of this story is phenomenal. Listen to this. And raised him up saying, arise quickly. Okay, Lord, I'll get up in the morning. I'll get up after a while, Lord. That's not what the scripture said. The angel told Peter, said, you got to get up quickly because God's going to do a quick work here. I said, God's going to do a quick work and you got to be quick. Amen? Quickly. Then he said, once he started getting up, his chains fell off from his hands. Most of the time when we're in Peter's condition here, we feel sorry for ourselves. I want that old devil to come in here and unlock these chains himself. He's the one that put me in here. You'll lay that the rest of your life. He ain't coming. Like Naaman, leprous man. Went to the prophet. And the prophet told his servant, said, you tell Naaman, go to the River Jordan, dip himself seven times. Oh, Naaman was leprous, but he had authority. He didn't like that. He wanted the main man to come out and say something to him himself. Sometimes we miss a lot. Sometimes we miss a lot when we don't take instructions. Or we want to complain. Naaman said, why didn't he come out here and prophesy and point his finger, go this way and do that? And servant come out and said, prophet said, go dip seven times in Jordan, you'll be clean. Turned around, went back in the house. Naaman's servant had to listen to the riffraff. I don't want to do that.
That preacher knows I don't like to do that. I don't want to do that. Amen. Amen? Could you ever think there might be a reason behind it? Did you ever think God might have some instructions behind that? Amen. Now listen. Naaman left, going down the road. Away, didn't even dip himself. Still leprous. How long do we want to live in that condition? How long do we want to live in that condition, y'all? Where we let the devil get the upper hand on us all the time. How long we want to live in that condition? Do we want to come out victorious and not have to deal with this thing again? Amen. Got down the road and Naaman's servant said, if he'd have told you to do something great, would you not have done it? Or something hard, would you not have done it? I'm paraphrasing now. If he had told you to do something that you couldn't hardly do, would you not have done that or paid any price? And all he asked you to do was just dip 7 times. Simple. A lot of times we want to make complicated the most simplistic things they are. Had a guy ask me Thursday, said, I really like for you to tell me what's the difference between Baptist and Assembly of God and Methodist and Assembly of God. Boy, I started rattling it off. Rattle. I mean, I just started giving it to him. And he sat there. And he mentioned another denomination. I told him the foundation of it at 300 A.D. I carried him all the way to now with it. He said, So the instructions there were, what kind of church you want to go to? I want to go to a Bible-believing, word-preaching, Holy Ghost-moving church. I want to go where sin's defeated. Sin is delivered out of people's lives. Jesus Christ. I want to go to a church where people's getting saved and where they sing the songs of Zion. I love that, Brother Robbie, that new Amazing Grace. I love that song. Amen. I love it. I know it's got a new tempo to it, but I love that song. What powerful words it is. Do we realize we are walking in the power of God's grace every single solitary day? That we breathe in the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ every single solitary day and we bathe ourselves in the Word and we bathe ourselves in the Spirit? Why in the world does the devil get his hand over us and an upper hand on us when we got so much of the power of God resting in us and on us and around us? What's our problem when we get in prison and can't get out? It's because we'd rather whine than fight. Now listen, what time is it? I'm fixing to start closing. Verse 8, and the angel said unto him, gird thyself. Now, I got some preaching right here now. Gird means you got to get yourself ready. You got to pick yourself up. Now, I'm preaching. I'm telling you something that you have to get dressed. After the battles, you still got to have the victory. After the battles, you still can't have that old lemon-eating face look. After the battles, you got to have joy. You got to be smiling. You got to be happy. Fool the devil. Well, I don't feel good. I don't feel happy. Fool the devil and just act like it anyway. Amen. Maybe it'll rub off on you. The angel said, you've got to gird yourself. In other words, I don't want you to present yourself to the outside world the way you are in prison. You've got to change from the way you was in prison to the outside world. They don't need to see who you were in prison. They need to know who you are in victorious. Amen. Now listen to this. Then he said this, bind on thy sandals. What's your feet shod with? Preparation of the gospel of peace. When you come out of there, you need to have the gospel on you. You need to be walking on the word. When you come out of there, your foundation needs to be sure. Amen? Because you're going to face people that's going to say, where you been all this time? I miss you. You ain't been in church in 3 weeks. I've been in prison. Nobody called me. They didn't even write me a letter. And so he did. And he said unto him, cast thy garment about thee and follow me. Two things here. You got to put your outside garment on. Then you got to follow. Oh, this is what the Lord showed me this morning. When we're following the angel, now the angel knows the way. He knows the way in and he knows the way out. And we start following him out. And he comes to a little intersection and the angel takes a right. And you say, no, you can't go that way. We've got to go this way. Hello? Follow me is what the angel said. God said, pick up your cross and follow me. So we have to follow Jesus. Whatever we do, we follow Jesus. Here's the highway. The highway's the word. Amen? So we got to follow Jesus. Peter followed the angel. Now you've got to understand, Peter wasn't conscious. He wasn't conscious that he left his surroundings. He wasn't conscious that the door to the prison cell was still closed. He wasn't conscious of any of this thing because the angel said, gird yourself, arise and gird yourself and follow me. Follow the angel. Follow the messenger. Follow the word. God dispatched him just for you, Peter. You've got to follow him. If you don't, you can't get out. If you don't follow him, you've got to follow the word. You've got to follow the angel. Now listen to this. And he went out and followed him. But now listen to these words. And wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. He didn't know how he got out of there. He thought he was just still asleep or in a vision. He didn't know how he got out of there. So when he got to that place where the angel got him to the outer court, and you see, you still got to face something here. There's a gate out here. This gate houses everything in here. This gate houses all prisoners, all jails, all guards, all chains. This compound inhabits all this stuff. So you was just one person in a system of people that's in the same condition you are. Amen? And they followed. Peter followed him. Now listen to this. And when they were past the first, verse 10, past the first and second ward, they came unto the iron gate that leadeth to the city. Here you are, you've made it through all the rest of it, and you come to the iron gate. The last process that you have to do before you're set free. Now listen, the reason that you're where you're at right here at this second is because the Spirit had brought you here. The Spirit had brought you here. I mean, you was in bondage in two chains, and the Spirit at your obedience girded yourself and rose up and put your garments on, and you got to this place here at that outer gate because the Spirit brought you here. How do we expect to win battles if we don't follow the Spirit? The leading of God, the leading of the Spirit. And listen, the Lord may not lead you in the same direction that you go all the time. Amen? I mean, the children of Israel wandered 40 years and they didn't go the same place twice, probably in the wilderness. And for 40 years, don't you know they told Moses, Moses, why don't we just stay over yonder? Let all these other folks die out, then we're going into the promised land. Am I making sense? Amen. Now listen to this. They got to the outer gate. Everything that I've preached about this morning is under subjection to God. You hear me? Every soldier, every chain, every door, every keeper is subject to God. There's not anything in our environment or our world that's not subject to God. Everything is subject to God. Everything is subject to the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God can move mountains you and I can't even think about moving. So here we are. Now Peter's in the Spirit here, following the angel, and he's at the outer gate.
Now, I need to stop there and tell you this. Jesus said, I am the door. There's no other door besides Christ. He said, I am the door. He's the door that leads us out of bondage. He's the door that leads us out of prison. He's the door that leads us out of confusion. He's the door that leads us out of depression. He's the door that leads us out of everything we can get ourselves in. He's that door. I am the door. So when they got to that last gate, now this last gate's bigger than the other ones because it has to hold the compound in. And in holding the compound in, that means it's got you there. But I need to stop and tell you this too. All them soldiers is in bondage. Amen. Why do we want to hook ourselves up with those folks that's in bondage? Amen. God help us. God help us. And when they got to that last gate, I want you to notice this. It opened by itself. When you make it to the outer gate, you don't have to worry about that outer gate because God's going to open that gate. It opened, and listen, that gate didn't have a choice. That gate didn't stay closed and say, I ain't opening now. We've had him so and so and so. I ain't letting him go. He couldn't do that. The gate can't hold you. The prison can't hold you. The chains can't hold you. And the soldiers can't hold you. The only one that holds you is yourself. We hold ourselves because we don't believe God's going to open that outer gate and turn us out to the city. And listen, I hope I've made a point this morning simply because of this. While we're going through what we're going through, somebody's praying down the street. Somebody's praying. Or you wouldn't last as long as you're lasting if somebody wasn't praying. I'm going to tell you this true story. There's a missionary overseas, and he was way out in the bush. And he needed $276 to purchase some kind of equipment. And he was praying, and he said, God, I know this is impossible, because at this particular time, a year's wages wasn't but about $20 to a common person there. A year's wages. So it would have took over 20 years to accumulate the money, but he had to have it right then. So he began to pray. And he prayed and he sought God for several weeks. Now, I'm going to use my right finger to pinpoint the missionary. We got a missionary with us this morning. And on the other spectrum, in the Rocky Mountains of Colorado, was a widow woman. She didn't have much. She had an old shack with a dirt floor, had an old coal-burning heater, and she was praying same time he was. She just happened to have $276. And God spoke to her and said, I want you to mail this to a missionary. And she got the address, she got a money order, and she mailed it to the missionary overseas. And one morning, the mail run. I don't know what he was expecting. I know that he was a believer, and I know that he was having to trust God because he is a missionary. And the mail that morning brought him a money order for $276. You see, God works on both ends at the same time. He never leaves a gap. He always works on both ends at the same time. So no matter what you're going through, there's an angel fighting for you and going to lead you. And don't worry about the outer gate this morning. God's going to take care of that. That's not the end of the story. When the missionary came back to the States to itinerate to go back, he looked this woman up. He kept the return address off of the envelope, and he looked this woman up. It took him a while to find her because she was not on a paved road. She wasn't on a dirt road. She was on a mountain path is where she lived. And he went as far as he could go on a vehicle, far as he could go on a bicycle, then he walked the rest of the way, getting instructions all along the way. And when he got to the shack where she lived, he was amazed. And he knocked on a little frail door. And this bent over lady came to the door. He said, "Are you so and so?" She said, "I sure am." He said, "Did you send a missionary some money here a while back?" She said, "I sure did. God spoke to me in prayer and told me to send that missionary some money." He said, "I'm that missionary. I'm the one." So you see, God don't use a millionaire, because a millionaire don't like to give. But he'll use somebody that's got a heart for God. You can't operate in your prison. But once you get out that front gate, there shouldn't be anything that you can't do. You understand that? There shouldn't be anything out here you can't do once you're out that gate. Stand with me this morning. Radio Land, we thank you for tuning in. I hope this message has ministered to you today. I would like to see you in our sanctuary on Sunday mornings or Sunday nights or Wednesday nights for a live service. You're welcome here at Luverne First Assembly, 788 Glenwood Road, Luverne, Alabama. I'm Pastor Keith Price. And these good people here at Luverne First Assembly wants to pray for you as we do daily, and we want you to come and be a part of one of our live services. I believe that you would enjoy, not only enjoy, but I believe God would minister to you. And as we pray this morning, I want you to bow your hearts and your heads with us as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, God, that every need be met, every sick body be healed. Lord Jesus, would you send your word and heal them? And Lord, those people that are in prison, Lord, without walls today, without bars, I pray, God, for deliverance on them. Lord, whatever it is, whether it's drugs or alcohol or pornography or gambling or whatever it is, God, would you deliver them this morning? Lord, would you give them instructions to arise and put on their garments? And God, that you would bring them to the great house of God. And Lord, when they walk into the house of God, let the Spirit of the Lord open that outer gate to the altar. And God, when they come to this altar, meet them here. Lord, let the heavenly host of heaven, God, encamp round about each one of them. Now, Lord, I'm careful to give you praise and glory for it. In Jesus' name. With every head bowed this morning, every eye closed. You see, I know that you've been in prison. But I showed you the way out this morning. The Lord showed you the way out. The Word showed you the way out. The Spirit led you out this morning. I want you to make a decision. It's so easy to be in a rut. It's so easy to go in circles. I needed to tell you this. On the plains of Africa, there's a beast they call the wildebeest. It's a cow-like animal. And there's a certain fly that flies in one of their ears and will lay an egg in their ear. And when that larva hatches out of that egg in the ear of that wildebeest, it'll start boring a hole in toward the brain. And that wildebeest will get what they call circling disease. And once they get that circling disease, it'll go in circle till it dies. Or a cripple in a lion will catch it. Sometimes we get things in our ears that cause us to walk in circles. Maybe it's a word. Maybe it's a gossip. Maybe it's a lie. But it keeps us in a circle. Keeps us from going to that outer gate where there's freedom to the city. This altar's open for you this morning. If you're lost and undone without Christ, it's open for you. He's a loving God. He's a merciful God. He's a long-suffering God. And He's calling on your heart here this morning. It's time to get out of prison. The way to get out is in this altar. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. It's not complicated. Forgive me of my sins. Would you come into my heart? Michelle's going to play and sing this song of invitation this morning. While she's playing and singing, you make that decision. You make that decision.
less of me,
more of you, Jesus.
Just like my Father longed to be, a spotless vessel that all might see. Storm the air in his of me.
I need to read you one more scripture. Peter said, "Now I know of a surety that the Lord hath sent his angel and hath delivered me out of the hand of Herod and from all the expectation of the people of the Jews." It doesn't matter what people expect you to do, but it matters what you expect God to do. David said in Psalm 62 and 5, "And my expectation is from him, not people." Not people. You can't operate on what people expect you to do. You have to operate on what God expects you to do. She's going to sing this next verse in a chorus. Would you come this morning? It's time to pray. Yes, Lord. Need special prayer, you're sick in your body, I want to pray for you. I believe the Lord's a healer this morning. Amen. I believe God's a healer. This way, Sister Judy's in the hospital with muscle spasms. I want us to have faith together and let's believe the Lord. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray for Sister Judy Peoples today. God, we ask you to send your word and heal her in the name of Jesus. Lord, I pray for that miracle, God, that miracle of healing. Lord, by the power of your spirit, God, I ask you to heal today in Jesus' name. Now, Lord, I give you praise for it, Lord, for we got confidence in you. And Lord, our expectation comes from you to heal Sister Judy Peoples today in Jesus' name. And Lord, I praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You need special prayer. I want you to come. Praise God. That's all. Just sit right there, sweet. Is it doing better?
June 2nd. I don't know if I'm going to be able to walk then.
We're going to pray. Amen. Because God's going to get you out of this prison. Amen. I believe that. Father, right now, lay hands on her. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we pray for Sister Pam right now, God, for a miracle of healing in her leg. Lord, would you knit these bones back together stronger than they've ever been before? God, would you heal her body where she can walk again in the name of Jesus? Lord, would you work a miracle and confound the doctors, God, that you've already been here and heal this leg in the name of Jesus? And Lord, heal this arm as well. But Lord, I pray this morning to strengthen her spirit, strengthen her fight this morning, God, to believe in you. In the name of Jesus, I ask you to pour out your spirit upon her. Lord, every day that the angels of heaven encamp round about her, God, to give her strength and power in the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, give her excitement to believe every morning, God, that it's going to be better. But Lord, we expect it from you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise the Lord. You need special prayer this morning. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Praise the Lord Jesus. Praise the Lord Jesus. Please keep Sister B's family in prayer as she has lost her mom. And the funeral will be at 2 o'clock at Turner's Funeral Home, and the graveside will be at Faith Hill, out 10, going toward Greenville. We are going to have a piano concert here, recital here, 2 o'clock. Sister Beth, you going to be here when they come? About 1 o'clock, okay. Is it all right if people set in on it? Anybody wants to come and sit, you need to. These are Koreans and different nationalities, so you need to be here. Amen. Remember, we are walls without church. I mean, a church without walls. Amen. Walls without church. Church without walls. Amen. I wish I could be here. I was excited about them coming. All hearts and minds clear. Brother Randy Barker and Sister Chris was ministering for Brother David and Sister Lenore Noble today at Church of God in Elba. Brother David had invited him to come and preach because they were involved in the funeral today. And I was excited for Brother Randy to get to preach down there. Amen. 5 o'clock this afternoon, we're going to have church. Sister Linda, come. You need to make some announcements. We've got Sunday Vacation Bible School. 2 weeks. I am. Amen. Hey, the Family Fun Day had 27 signed up. Family Fun Day to be here.
You love the Lord, raise your hand. Amen. Who
Amen.
Said we don't have volunteers?
Amen. I'm one. I'll be in two places at one time if I can.
I'm telling you. Vacation Bible School is upon us. Quick. Got here quick this year. Next week, Tuesday and Thursday, we're going to have work day here. And it's going to be from 9 to 12. So, Beth, like with your room, any crafts that you want need help with, decorations. If you are in a leader's robe that you could, you know, like Sister Marcy and Emma has over an activity, if you do not have it all down that you're going to, how you're going to decorate, where you can get help on that, that's what these workshops are for.
Amen.
Also, next Sunday, I hope this is all right, next Sunday at 3:30, everyone that has volunteered, I need to see you here at church at 3:30 in Fellowship Hall, because we've got to go over some things. I'm take the list of people I already got, and we'll go ahead and break them down, and I'm going to give you a copy of that list if you're a team leader. And then that next week, I want you praying over that list on these kids, because that's what we're here for. We're here to minister to the kids. And also, Sister Michelle is going to get us a list for the food on things that can be given to us to help out the church, for the church won't be in such a big expense. She's going to have that list next Sunday, so you can get with her and sign up and for what you can bring. Also, for decorations, I need ferns. If any of y'all have ferns or potted plants, artificial like these that can stand up, if you have anything like that that you can help us with the decoration, because we're going to try to use a lot of greenery. If you can do that, we'll let you put your name on the pot, bring it in there to Sunday before Vacation Bible School, because we're going to start decorating the foyer Monday. Because when we start revival, Brother Price has done okay it. We want to show how it's going to be looking there in the foyer. So if you can help out with this, I would appreciate it. And we'll try to, if they're live plants, we'll try to make sure they don't die.
Amen.
But if you can help us with that. Also, we're fixing to start the nursery, having it every Sunday for people who have small kids. If you can volunteer to do the nursery on Sundays, I need to know where I can go ahead and make out a schedule. And also for revival, Brother Price, we don't talk about that. We need to have a nursery during revival, so we need somebody to volunteer for that too, so it won't be the same ones over there. So get with me. Let me know if you can do both, or you want just want to do Sunday mornings, or you want to do just revivals. So get with me afterwards, because we're here to serve.
That's right.
And when people come in, we want to serve them so they can get a blessing out of this and want to come back and serve the Lord with us. So if you would, keep praying for our Vacation Bible School. Pray for our kids that are going to come, and pray that they'll get a blessing and they'll know more about the Lord when they leave.
Amen.
And that's our mission. And I appreciate you letting me have the time.
Amen. Our mission statement is winning souls by all means. That means if we have to have a piano recital, we're going to have one. Whatever we can do to further the kingdom of God, that's what we're going to do. If it takes that to get a Korean in here, hey, we're a church without walls.
Is it okay if I give them visitors packets?
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. It's good to have the Skinners with us today, missionaries to Troy University. Give them a hand. All hearts and minds clear. All repentance made. Stand with me. Brother Randy Rogers, would you pray and dismiss us with prayer?
Lord, we just love you today, Lord. And we just thank you for being in our presence. My son.